The barely sentient puppet president of the United States has completely botched the withdrawal from Afghanistan. Regardless of the varying opinions on whether we should have withdrawn or not, and about what the U.S. has been doing while we were there, Biden messed up badly, demonstrating his foreign policy decisions are just as bad now as they have been for the past 40 years. Shockingly, people across political and international lines overwhelmingly agree. A few do not. Here in the U.S., some in the media are so dedicated to being propagandists for the president, they've tried to minimize Biden's blunder by suggesting that the people we abandoned Afghanistan to, the Taliban, are actually not that bad. They've reformed. Those who aren't completely stupid have remained skeptical of such optimistic claims. Not surprisingly, such skepticism is justified. I'll put some links to these articles in the description box. You can read them in full if you like. I'll just summarize. The Taliban is going door to door, seeking Christians, searching through phones for Bible apps. Afghan Christians are reportedly fleeing to the mountains in a desperate attempt to escape the Taliban, who is going door to door, trying to kill them. They have a hit list of known Christians that they're targeting. The U.S. Embassy is defunct and has no safe place for them. This article contains a side note on the way the Taliban is advancing women's rights in Afghanistan. They're going door to door, taking women and children. The people must mark their house with an X if they have a girl over 12 years old, so that the Taliban can take them. Back to the Taliban and their sudden interest in the Bible. Of course, they're looking for physical Bibles, but also searching through people's phones to look for any apps that will give them away as Christians. And just like good tyrants do, the Taliban have spies and informants everywhere. Anyone identified as a Christian could be killed for their faith, and they risk betrayal or falling victim to an honor killing by their own family members. The Taliban have claimed, of course, that they will run Afghanistan according to Sharia law. One of their first actions is to confiscate Bibles and to kill Christians, as we've seen. Why is that such a priority? For that matter, why do we see so much Bible phobia in the Muslim world in general? In my view, there are at least two ways to answer that question. First, from a Christian perspective, Taliban-style opposition to Christians and to the Bible could easily be seen as Satan working instrumentally through the Taliban and other Bible phobes. Indeed, when we look at the Taliban's treatment of women and girls, it's difficult even for moral relativists to deny the outworking of pure evil. How easy it is then for Christians, when we see the Taliban's opposition to the Bible, to detect a corresponding supernatural evil at play. Second, and apart from the Christian worldview, it's difficult not to see the Taliban's desire to confiscate Bibles as a product of fear. Here in the U.S., as in many other places and many other times, censorship is being used to silence opposition. Those doing the censoring are correctly regarded as cowards. They're afraid of ideas. Ideas different from those that agree with their own are dangerous. They make them uncomfortable. And often, the content being censored is content that cannot easily be dispensed with. Many of us have realized that if Amazon censors a book, you should probably read it. And if YouTube or Twitter deplatforms someone, they might be worth looking into. And it does no good whatsoever to point out the hypocrisy of these platforms, giving space at the same time to legitimately dangerous voices like the Taliban, while they silence other voices, simply because they don't agree with them and can't refute them. Censorship in the West, just like anywhere else, is about agenda and ideology, not about consistency. The parallels with authoritarian censorship here in the West and with the Taliban are worth noting. Like authoritarians here, the Taliban and many Muslim countries are afraid of the Bible. The Bible contradicts and condemns them and their books and people like their prophet. The Bible shows the religion of Islam is anything but Abrahamic and ignorant of the theology and writing of Moses, shaking the very core identity of Islam. Taking on Christianity or competing ideologies head-on would be too much work, and it's bound to fail. So they take the authoritarian approach. In a splendid display of fear, the Taliban arm themselves and go door to door looking for a book. A book so scary it has to be destroyed. And that's what the Bible, Christians, and girls 12 years and older in Afghanistan all have in common. The Taliban want to destroy them one way or another. They're cowards, murderers, and rapists. And what about Sharia-loving Muslim apologists? Will they flock to the new Sharia paradise implemented by the Taliban? Nope, they're cowards too. Muslim cowards in the West afraid of Muslim cowards in the East. So many cowards, so little courage. Speaking of courage, to see a Christian perspective in Afghanistan, I'll put a couple of links in the description box until YouTube censors them to protect the reputation of the Taliban, their brothers in authoritarianism. This Christian pledges to continue the work in Afghanistan while the Taliban go door to door on their killing and raping rampages, which seem all too reminiscent of what we read in the Hadith about Muhammad and his band of merry men. But what can we do for Christians in Afghanistan? That and other similar questions are very important, and they need to be asked and answered in substantial ways. But I want to end this video with a different question. What can Christians like those in that video do for us, prosperous, comfortable Christians in the West? A lot is the answer. Christians too frequently get sucked into pathetic, narcissistic Western attempts to wax eloquent about all of the various forms of oppression in the West and who's oppressed more and who's oppressing who at one particular day of the week and blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, Westerners are completely blind to actual oppression. Or when they do notice it on the rare occasions they decide to peek up over the top of their smartphones and take a glance ever so briefly into the larger world around them, they have short memories. Since Westerners have no idea what actual oppression is like, they mistake their action in the face of contrived oppression as heroic, courageous, and virtuous. In reality, it's all virtue signaling garbage in a prosperous society that has no dragon to slay. Thus, people must create their own dragon to slay for themselves with just their bare hands, virtue signaling, and selfies so that they and everyone around them can celebrate their courage. And you better celebrate too. Otherwise, you'll hurt the feelings of the dragon slayers. Just as the Sharia-loving cavemen who call themselves the Taliban show us what cowards look like, so Christians in Afghanistan remind us what courage looks like. So let me ask some questions of the Christians living in whatever prosperous, safe country you may be watching from. Have you lowered your voice recently in a public setting when discussing Christianity? Have you compromised on biblical principles to satisfy the ridiculous trends of Western society, which, by the way, will change in another 5 years? Have you kept silent on an issue when you should have spoken out with biblical authority? We could go on and on with similar questions, but you get the point. If the answer is anywhere close to yes, then you don't have a tenth of the courage of Christians in Afghanistan or many other countries where Christians are in similar situations. So if that describes you, fix yourself. Christians in the West need to learn the meaning of real courage. Things are going to get a lot worse over here before they get better, if they ever do. So yes, pray for the Christians under tyranny, but pray to be like them as well. That's what we can learn from courageous Christians in Afghanistan and the cowards of the Taliban. It's not hard to figure out which one will have the final victory. Thanks so much for watching. I'll see you next time.